Good evening, everyone. My name is Kevin, and the topic for my presentation today is on high-speed rail. A bit about myself, firstly. I've recently just finished serving a four-year sentence, also known as a virtual engineering degree, at the University of Newcastle. As the title suggests, I'm a bit of a training enthusiast, and which is why the topic is one of my favourites. And interestingly, it's got quite a bit of media attention recently. The first time I've experienced high-speed rail was in 2010, when I was visiting my dad in Beijing, China. We caught the train from Beijing to Tianjin, a city that was fairly close, about the same distance from here to Sydney. With the high-speed, the trip was only half an hour. But what was really impressive was how comfortable the ride was. It was very smooth, very quiet, heaps of legroom. Not that I needed much, but very comfortable, more comfortable than an airplane ride. And that's the first time I experienced how cool high-speed rail was. Now, you can imagine the contrast I got when I got back to Australia and I was catching the train from Sydney to Newcastle. I was aging as the minute goes by. And that's when I became so fascinated with it. The goal of my presentation today is hopefully share my interest and knowledge of this wonderful technology, and hopefully by the end of the presentation, you'll be excited about it as I am. So, the high-speed rail originated in Japan, with the first line linking Tokyo and Osaka, two heavily populated cities. When the line was first opened in 1964, the train had a top speed of 210 kilometres. The trip, which was about 500 kilometres, took just over 3 hours to complete. But that was half of what was original before. 50 years later, there are now over 40 countries in the world that have high-speed rail underway, five of which that have developed their own high-speed rail technology. So, how does high-speed rail work? Well, a lot of high-speed rail technology is due to cutting-edge engineering, one of which is the electric multiple unit. So if we think about, to be classified as a high-speed by the International Union of Railway, the train has to have a top speed above 200 kilometres an hour. Well, this is very difficult to do for the traditional system, where all the train carriages are hauled by one locomotive at the front. This is because of a simple friction law, which is F equals UN. I was first taught this when I was in high school, and back then we called it the Fun formula, because friction is fun. The Fun formula says that the frictional force between any two variables is determined two surfaces is determined by two variables. One of which is U, the coefficient of friction. This value could be up to 1. Obviously, the bigger the U, the bigger the frictional force. And the coefficient changes depending on the surfaces. For example, rubber on asphalt is close to 1. This is why our cars can accelerate the road very well. The second variable is N, which is the vertical force between the two surfaces. Normally, this is determined by the weight of the object. If we apply this concept to the rail system and we say we want speeds above 200 kilometres, no matter how powerful we make the locomotive, if there isn't enough frictional force between the wheel and the train will just sit there and do burnouts. So, on the other hand, if we have an EMU system, this means that every carriage is a locomotive itself that's capable of moving. This means that all the motor power is distributed to all the carriages, and we overcome the problem we had before. Now, because there are more friction force between the carriages, we can have higher acceleration and deceleration, which is really quite cool. One interesting fact about doing research for this presentation was high-speed trains actually drop sand on their track as where they were first starting to further increase the coefficient of friction, which is quite neat. So you can probably guess I'm a fairly big supporter for high-speed rail in Australia. But there are people out there that think that Australia shouldn't have high-speed rail. Their main arguments are Australia simply does not have the population density for it. Our cities are just too far apart for a rail system, and flights are just so cheap that you lose all economic incentives. These are valid arguments. But I think as a country, we need to plan ahead. We can't build infrastructure today based on the numbers and the population we have. So, if we, or there's been a number of proposal studies on why Australia should have high-speed rail ever since the 1980s, and the most recent one is done by Beyond Zero Emission. The study proposed a 1,800-kilometre track that linked Brisbane, Sydney, Canberra and Melbourne. With an average speed of 250 kilometres, Sydney to Melbourne can be covered under 3 hours, and Sydney to Brisbane can be covered just under 3 hours. So, let's talk about going to Sydney for a weekend trip. So my argument why Australia should have high-speed rail is quite simple. We simply need a fast and reliable transportation system that links our major cities and smaller cities such as Newcastle that does not require fossil fuel to operate. Now, what was really interesting about this link is the areas that it covers between the major cities. Like, cities such as Newcastle, Wagga Wagga, Port Macquarie and Albury all lies within the path of the high-speed rail. What this means that people will be able to work in those cities but still live in regional areas. If we use Newcastle as an example, Newcastle to Sydney on this track is only 40 minutes. This means I could potentially work in Sydney but still live in Newcastle, where there are a lot more opportunities. I could finish work by 5 and go home by 7 and eat dinner made by my mum, which is always good. So, which brings to the biggest advantage, let's say, on the selling point of high-speed rail is urban decentralisation. Australia, as big as it is, 50% of our population lives in one of the big three cities. And this creates problems such as unaffordable housing, high pollution and high traffic. The growth of Sydney, Melbourne and Brisbane is simply not sustainable, with the population of Melbourne and Sydney expected to double in the next 30 years. Despite Australia only have a population of 23 million, our flight path is one among the world's busiest. Sydney to Melbourne is ranked number 4th in the world, outranking Los Angeles to San Francisco. Sydney to Brisbane is ranked number 13th, and Brisbane to Melbourne is ranked number 36th. These are the statistics that only Qantas will be proud of. The high-speed rail will not only reduce the pressure on these domestic airports, but also brings these regional Australia within the reach of economic centres. It can begin to deliver visitors to the truly unique outback and coastal area of Australia. So, the other big advantage of high-speed rail is economic growth. Like I mentioned before, I can work in urban areas but live outside of them. The expected return on such a high-speed rail system is $1 to $2.40. And to me, I mean, I think that's a pretty good investment. So, based on high demand of energy demand of the high-speed rail, this creates an opportunity for us to explore renewable energy resources. Resources such as photovoltaic and wind, both Australia's very highly suited for. With our world-class universities and our research institutes, we have the capacity for innovation and implementation. In some ways, the high-speed rail could be our first step we take towards a zero-carbon country. On top of that, Australia has a high amount of wealth, which means that we can afford to invest into renewable infrastructures and research. The development of renewable energy will make Australia a green country and a huge energy powerhouse, and create an alternative to the dependence of fossil fuel and coal exports. So, a look at the future. Australia really need a new focus for ongoing prosperity. Huge amount of investments has been done in the past on coal exploitation and coal extraction to developing Asian countries. However, those trading partners such as India and China, they're already transitioning to a low carbon development. Yet Australia, we're still supporting reinvestment into coal exploitation and extraction despite the low return. Solar farms like this, I believe, should be the focus of the investment right now. And I truly believe these are what's going to power our homes, our high-speed rail, and our electric cars. And I think the high-speed rail should be our first step we take towards that direction. Thank you.